In this lecture, we will learn about the different factors that govern steering alignment, the important factors like caster, camber, toe in and toe out, and also about the steering mechanisms and steering gearboxes, the different types of steering mechanisms that are used in automobiles. So we'll discuss first about the different factors that help in steering alignment. So steering alignment takes place where the components are placed in the right position to maintain the balance of all the steering component assemblies, and it ensures safety and proper operation of the vehicle. Now let us look at very important concept known as the center point inclination. So in center point inclination, as we have discussed, we have a kingpin which is being shown here. So the kingpin is the joint about which the stub axle swivels or it turns. So when the vehicle is in running condition, when the wheels are touching the ground, a downward force is acting on the wheel. And suppose the wheel is fixed in the stub axle, suppose this is the tire, this is the wheel and this is the tire alignment. Suppose this is the tire. And when the vehicle is in running condition, we can see that a downward force is acting through the kingpin and a reaction force from the road is acting, or from the ground is acting, in the upward direction. And suppose that this kingpin and the point about which the wheel is connected or wheel is aligned with the stub axle, it is separated by a distance of small x. So you can see that there are two different forces that are acting. One is R and the other is F, and there is a small distance of x that is separating these two forces. So this will produce a turning couple, because there are two different forces which are forces acting in opposite directions, and it is separated by a small distance. So it will produce a turning effect or a couple. And that turning effect is given by force into the distance, F into X. So that is being shown here. So force into distance will give you the couple or the turning force, or the turning moment. So this force F into X, the turning force, will become very large when we apply the front brakes, because this force will increase. And the resultant turning force becomes larger, and when this force becomes larger, it will result in heavy steering. Heavy steering means it will become difficult to turn the vehicle by using the steering wheel. That is because the distance between the kingpin and the center line of the wheel is increasing due to this turning force. So suppose when the turning force increases, or the force increases, the wheel gets, the inclination of the wheel changes slightly like this. So the distance between the center and the kingpin will increase more than x. It will become greater than x. So if the increasing distance, if the distance is increasing, then it will further increase the heavy steering phenomenon. So in order to overcome or avoid this disadvantage of heavy steering, always we try to align the kingpin center and the center of the wheel to a very nearby position, or in other words, we try to minimize this distance, offset distance x. So when we try to minimize x, the steering will become more lighter. So always the objective will be to reduce the distance between the kingpin axis and the center along which, or the point at which the wheel is mounted. We have to reduce this value of x. So there are certain mechanisms or certain methods by which we can reduce this offset distance x. And when the offset is eliminated, that is when the center line of the wheel meets the center line of the kingpin, that is when both these centers meet together, then it is known as center point steering. So center point steering is the condition required for a very light steering or very easy steering of the vehicle. Now there are different mechanisms by which we can achieve the center point steering. Center point steering means we are reducing this offset distance x such that the center line of the wheel will meet the center line of the kingpin. So the first method is by introducing a camber. Now camber is a camber or camber, we can call it both ways. Camber is a angle. I'll show you the figure, you'll understand it better when you are showing the figure. So this is the suspension system and this is the stub axle. The wheel is mounted in the stub axle, and here you can see that the wheel is making an angle with the vertical. So suppose this is the 90 degree vertical drawn, you can see that the axis of the wheel is at a small angle from the vertical axis. So this small distance of tilt or this angle is known as camber. When the outer end of the wheel is facing outwards and the inner side of the wheel, which is touching the ground or the road, is facing inwards, so this condition is known as positive camber. So in positive camber, the wheel forms a cone. Suppose we are drawing an axis through the center of the wheel, so it will come like this. Suppose this is the axis. So you can see that imaginary cone can be formed when we are extending this line. A cone is formed. So if such a cone is formed, then it is known as a positive camber. If the wheel is given a positive camber, then there are certain advantages. The bending stress that is exerted on the stub axle, the axle where the wheel is mounted, it can be reduced. So the main advantage of providing a positive camber is the bending stresses can be minimized on the stub axle. But it has certain disadvantages also, that is when the wheel angle is caused with a positive camber, it will result in different rolling radii. That means since the wheel is tilted at an angle, the wheel or the tire will not be correctly, or the center of the tire will not be correctly touching the ground. You can see that the outer portion of the tire or the wheel, the outer portion of this tire will be more in contact with the road, whereas the inner portion will not be in contact with the road. So as a result, you can see that the outer portion gets worn out very easily, because that is a portion which is in contact with the ground, whereas this portion is not contacting the ground. So finally, when you are after running through some distance, some thousands of kilometers, you can see that the shape of the tire, if you are drawing it, it will be coming like this, and it will be in this manner. That means if this is in the center of the tire, so this portion has worn out because of the camber. So positive camber has such disadvantages. It results in cone effect, which causes tire wear on the outer edge of the tire, and positive camber also reduces the offset, which results in lighter steering. So the lighter steering is caused because suppose the kingpin is shown here. Suppose you can see that the kingpin, suppose this is the kingpin axis and the axis of the tire, it is at a very small distance. So we are trying to reduce that offset distance of x. So when it is minimized, you can see that suppose this is the kingpin, the axis is like this and the axis of the tire is like this, it is coming and meeting at a point. So the offset is zero. So if the offset is reduced, then we can say that it will produce a lighter steer. Whereas if there is a larger offset, it will result in a heavier steer. Then the front wheel, when it is viewed from the front, if the stub axle is made so that it tilts the wheel, there is an angle formed between the vertical and the wheel center line, and that angle is called as the camber angle. When the wheel tilts outwards at the top and at the bottom it is tilting inwards, it is known as positive camber. And when the wheel is the other way around, that is, the wheel is tilting inwards at the top and outwards at the bottom, it is known as a negative camber. And this camber, it is represented as an angle, camber angle. And camber angle, positive camber angle or negative camber angle, it is expressed in degrees. And when you are applying a camber angle on one wheel, the same camber angle should be given to the other front wheel also. So if you are giving a positive camber on one front wheel, the same positive camber should be given to the other front wheel also. If the camber is unequal, then the vehicle will try to move to one side, or it will pull to one side of where the wheel has greater camber angle. So it will cause a disbalance. So in order to avoid this disbalanced movement, equal camber angles are provided on both the front tires. So we discussed what is positive camber. In positive camber, the outer or the top surface is known as coming, or it is leaning outwards, and the inner surface is leaning inwards. Now negative camber is the other way around, when the top portion of the wheel is tilting inwards and the bottom portion is tilting outwards. You can see the difference between the positive camber and negative camber. So in negative camber also, you can see that if this is the kingpin, the axis of the kingpin and the central axis of the tire is meeting at a point, and therefore there is the offset distance is zero. The offset distance x is zero. So when the offset is zero, it will produce a lighter steering. But in negative camber, the case is that in negative camber, it increases the offset. Negative camber will increase the offset, and when more load is kept, the axis will again shift further. And this is the normal axis, the normal axis of the tire. But when negative camber is given, this will be the new axis of the tire. And if you have a kingpin located here, this will be the kingpin axis. So as a result, you can see that there is an offset that is occurring between these two axes. So in the case of negative camber, there is an offset distance of Vx when load is increasing, and therefore it will produce a heavier steer. When the load is lessened, when the load is removed, the negative camber decreases and the offset distance will reduce somewhat, but a small offset distance will be there. So negative camber will always have a heavier steering when compared to a positive camber. A negative camber will also increase the tire wear as the camber angle increases, because only one portion of the tire is in contact with the road. Then what is the advantage of negative camber? Or why are we giving negative camber? Negative camber is given to vehicles, or when negative camber is given, it will help in cornering. Cornering means when the vehicle is undergoing a turn. So it will improve vehicle handling when the vehicle is cornering or when it is turning. That is the main advantage of giving a negative camber. Now, if the tire pressures are unequal, it will cause the vehicle to pull to one side while driving. So due to the negative camber also, when the tire pressures are unequal, it will, or the tire, vehicle will be pulled forcefully to one side. Therefore, when the tires undergo a puncture or when the tire bursts, the vehicle will violently go to one side of the road or one will move along one direction very forcefully, so it is very difficult to control. And in case of certain automobiles which have independent suspension systems, the camber angles will vary as the spring deflects. So in this case, the camber angle can be changed from positive to negative and vice versa. It will undergo change from positive to negative and again back to positive. Camber angle increases tire wear, and therefore a larger camber angle cannot be given, or can give a maximum of up to 2 degrees of camber angle. Many cars today adopt a negative camber, which improves handling but has a heavier steering action. So in order to give more control to the car during turning, a negative camber is given to the wheels. So even though the negative camber will increase, or it will cause heavier steering action, we use power steering or power assisted steering mechanism to reduce the heavier steering and to lighten the effort of the driver. So the driver will not need to give more effort to turn the steering. So that is achieved by power assisted or power steering mechanism. Now, the second method by which we can reduce this offset distance is by swivel axis inclination or kingpin inclination. So the kingpin, if we are tilting the kingpin so that the axis of the kingpin will meet the axis of the wheel below the road, then we can reduce the offset distance, or we can make the offset distance to zero. So by reducing the offset distance, the effort can be minimized. So tilting the kingpin is also known as kingpin inclination or KPI. It is also known as swivel axis inclination or SAI in cases where the kingpin is absent. So in modern vehicles, kingpin will not be there and kingpin is replaced with a swivel axis pin. That is known as swivel axis inclination. Now, in most vehicle steering layouts, they require a steering or a swivel axis inclination of 5 degree to 10 degrees to obtain the required offset. That is, the swivel axis inclination or the angle at which the kingpin or the swivel axis is inclined is between 5 to 10 degrees. And larger angles, swivel axis angles, are used when the designer moves the wheel away from the swivel axis joints to accommodate different components such as bearings, brakes, etc. So this small angle will help to reduce or help to minimize the offset distance between the kingpin and the axis of the wheel. So when it is reduced, the effort can be minimized. Turning effort can be minimized. We can give a negative offset or a positive offset. In earlier times, a positive offset was used by making the center line of the wheel meet the swivel axis at the point below the road. So this is known as the positive offset, where the center line of the kingpin, this line will meet the center line of the wheel below the road at a point. That is known as positive offset. When one tire deflates or when the air is removed, the positive offset on that side will increase. So because when tire pressure is removed, this angle will increase, the angle will decrease and the offset will increase. So when offset increases, the vehicle will pull violently to one side of the deflated tire and it is difficult for the driver to control the vehicle. So that is the problem of giving a positive offset. So when giving a positive offset and when tire puncture occurs, such accidents can happen. When a negative offset is given, the stability is improved further and it is obtained by increasing the inclination of the swivel axis further than in the past in order to give an intersection point above the road surface. So in the case of a negative inclination, in the case of negative inclination, you can see that the intersection point between these two lines will be at a point above the road surface. So that is more stable, and therefore such accidents will not happen. It will give more stability to the wheels. Another advantage of using negative geometry or negative offset geometry is that when front brakes are applied, the unbalanced cost due to poor adhesion of one wheel or the failure of one front brake will not lead to an accident. So when front brakes are unbalanced, that is when front brake on one wheel is acting more than the front brake on the other wheel, then accidents may occur. But in the case of providing a negative offset, the vehicle can be brought to rest in a straight line. That means more stability will be given to the wheels. So negative offset is more advantageous than providing a positive offset. You can see the figure here. This is the positive offset, where this is the kingpin inclination. The kingpins are inclinated at an angle, so the axis passes through like this, and this is the axis of the tire. So these two will be meeting at a point below the road surface. When the tire is deflated, you can see the axis will change. The kingpin will become, the axis through the kingpin will become almost vertical, and therefore this offset distance will increase. So that means the stability will decrease and the steering becomes very tight. Whereas in the case of a negative camber, you can see the angle is more and the point of intersection of the kingpin with the central line of the wheel is at a point above the road in the case of negative camber. And even if the tire deflates, you can see that at road surface the point will intersect, or the offset distance, we can say that it is very small. So the vehicle will be more stable even if the tire is deflating. So this is in the case of a negative offset. So negative offset is given, or it is providing more stability to the vehicle than the positive offset. Then the third phenomenon by which we can produce a lighter steering is by providing a caster. Caster is applied to the geometry to enable a driver to feel the straight ahead position, that is to give a self-centering action. Too much caster produces heavy steering, and too little will cause difficulty in steering. Now, what is actually caster? So if you have if you look at the rear wheel from a side view, this will be the side view, and this is the shock absorber mechanism or the suspension system mechanism. This is the kingpin. If you are drawing an axis through the kingpin and through the center of the wheel in this direction, you can see that it is meeting at a point, and this particular angle between the vertical and the axis is known as the caster angle. This is the front portion or the front side of the vehicle, and this angle is known as the caster angle. And you can see that the axis that is passing through through the kingpin, it is at a forward position, or it is at a position at the front than the point which is, or the intersection point of the vertical axis. So this is the intersection point of the vertical axis, and this is the intersection point of the axis that is passing through the kingpin. So this distance is known as the caster trail, and this is known as positive caster. Positive caster occurs when the intersection point of the axis through the kingpin falls in the front when compared to the axis intersection point. If it is the other way around, that is, if the suspension is or the suspension was in this direction and this is the axis of the axis passing through the kingpin and this is the vertical axis, then you can see that the intersection point of the or intersection point of the axis is falling at a point at the back of the intersection that is caused by the normal vertical axis. So in this case, this is known as the negative camber. So negative camber occurs in such an arrangement where the axis line passing through the kingpin is falling at a point at the back of the intersection point caused by the vertical. If it is the other way around, that is, the intersection is at the front than that of the vertical line, it is known as a positive cusp. So the caster is obtained by mounting the vertical pin in front of the wheel or by inclining the kingpin forward at the bottom to give a caster angle, and the angle is usually between 2 degree to 5 degree. Now the inclination of the axis can be arranged by different methods, that is, by using upper independent suspension members can be mounted slightly to the rear of the lower members. And again, such mechanisms are there which are not much concerned to us. Then we discussed about positive caster and negative caster. When the pivot center line contacts with the rod in front of the center line of the wheel, it is positive caster. And it is common for a rear wheel drive vehicle and unsuitable for a front wheel drive and four wheel drive vehicle. So positive caster is usually used for a rear wheel drive vehicle, whereas a negative caster is used for a rear wheel drive vehicle. It is used for a front wheel drive vehicle. Then the final phenomenon or the mechanism of making a lighter steering is toe in and toe out. So toe in and toe out is described by this figure. So when you are viewing the front side of the car, when the tires are diverging outwards like this, it is known as toe out. And when you are viewing the car from the front side, if the tires are converging in such a fashion, it is known as toe in. So we have toe in and toe out, the arrangement that are made to the wheels. So both wheels on each axle should be parallel when the vehicle is traveling in a straight line. And to achieve this condition, an allowance must be made for the change in alignment between the stationary and moving position. On a rear wheel drive vehicle, the forces exerted on the front wheels when the vehicle is moving forward, it will take up very small clearances in each ball joint and also produce slight deflection in steering linkages. And any flexible bushings for steering components will allow small movements and changes in the geometry. So this results the wheels to splay out or move outwards. On front wheel drive, the vehicle forces created by the driving wheels can cause the wheels to splay in or move inwards. So toe in means when the distance between front of the wheels is smaller than distance between rear of the wheels, and toe out is just the vice versa, that is, the distance at the front of the wheels is greater than at the rear of the wheels. Most rear wheel drive vehicles have wheels set so that the distance between front wheel rims is 1.5 to 3 mm shorter than the rear of the same wheel. So if you notice a vehicle, the distance between the front wheels is shorter, somewhat slightly shorter than the rear wheels. So what is the function of setting the toe in and toe out? Toe setting is determined by carrying out tests to find out values that gives minimum tire wear. So usually, tire wear minimization is one of the objective of setting a toe in or a toe out. Now let us check what are the different steering system components. So steering system consists of the steering wheel, the steering column, steering gearbox, and the different linkages which will help in the steering mechanism. So the steering gear system or the steering gearbox has, or it provides the driver with a system, lever system, which enables a large force to be exerted at the rod wheels with a minimum of driver effort. So that means the driver has to give only a small amount of effort, and this effort will be magnified by the gearbox system, and it will convert the smaller force to a larger force to turn the wheels that is in contact with the rod. And the steering gearbox should also allow the driver to control the direction of the vehicle accurately. That means the turning of the steering wheel and turning of the actual wheel of the vehicle should be proportionate. The overall ratio between the steering wheel and the rod wheel varies from 18:1 to 35:1, and this ratio is known as steering ratio. That means the ratio between the angle of turning of the steering wheel with the angle of turning of the rod wheel is known as steering ratio. So when we are turning steering wheel through a greater angle, the rod wheels turn by a smaller angle. That is why the ratio comes like 18:1 or 35:1. So that means if you are turning the steering wheel through an angle of 18 degrees, the actual rod wheel will turn through an angle of 1 degree. That is known as steering ratio. As the ratio is lowered, large number of turns are required to move the steering wheel from lock to lock. So that will encounter difficulty because many turns make it difficult to change vehicle direction rapidly. Now, steering gearboxes are usually used with larger vehicles like large vans, trucks, and buses. And usually lighter cars in earlier days used steering box mechanism. But nowadays, a rack and pinion mechanism is used in lighter cars, in cars and lighter vehicles. Only heavier vehicles use steering gearboxes. And various types of gearbox mechanisms are available, like worm and sector gear, screw and nut mechanism, recirculating ball mechanism, cam and peg, worm and roller mechanism. So these are the different mechanisms that are available in steering gearboxes. And then we have the very commonly used rack and pinion arrangement, which modern light vehicles are using it nowadays. So let us see how the worm and sector gear mechanism works. So this mechanism is developed from a worm and wheel, which is a very earlier design of a gearbox. In this, we have a case hardened steel worm, and the sector, which is made by malleable iron or light alloy casting. So here you can see the different parts of the worm and sector gearbox mechanism. We have the drop arm, and then the rocker shaft, and we have the sector gear, because we know what is a sector is of a circle, of a small portion of the circle is known as the sector. And this is the shape of the gear is such that it is like a small portion of a circle. That is why it is known as a sector gear. So we have the sector gear, then we have the worm mechanism here, and we have the filler plug and the inner column. Inner column is the steering box column or the steering column. And then we have the rocker shaft and the other backlash adjustments. So the mechanism is very simple. When we are moving or when we are turning the steering, the inner column or the steering column will rotate, and the steering column is attached with the worm wheel. The worm wheel also rotates, and the worm wheel is engaged with the sector gear so that the sector gear will rotate accordingly. So when the sector gear is rotating or it is turning, the rocker shaft which is attached with the sector gear will also turn. So we are converting the rotational motion of the steering wheel in one direction to the rotational motion of the rocker shaft in another direction. So when this rocker shaft rotates, since this drop arm is linked or fixed to this rocker shaft, it will also reciprocate or it will also rotate in a different direction. And this rocker or the drop arm is connected with the linkage system like the tie rod or the tie rod link, and it will pull or push the tie rod such that the stub axle will turn and thereby the wheel will also turn. So that is the mechanism of worm and sector. That is, when the steering wheel rotates, it will rotate the steering column, and steering column, since it is attached with the worm wheel also rotates. The worm wheel, since it is engaging with the sector gear also moves and rotates in that direction, and it will cause the rocker shaft to rotate, and the rocker shaft will again cause the movement of the drop arm, and the drop arm will cause the movement of the tie rod link or the tie rod, and the tie rod will again cause the movement of the stub axle, and stub axle in turn will move the wheel of the vehicle. The stub axle movement can be represented or shown by a video for better understanding. You can see the video how the mechanism works. So this is known as the sector gear, and this is on form of the worm gear. So the sector gear is in contact with the worm gear. Actually, this is not a worm, this is another addition or another change to the worm gear known as a recirculating ball mechanism, which we will learn later on. So this sector gear will be in contact with the worm wheel, and when the worm wheel rotates, you can see when the worm wheel moves, it will move the sector gear and also the other components that are attached with the sector gear. And since this linkage will be attached to the steering linkages like the tie rod joint and the tie rod arm, etc., it will move the tie rod arm and finally the stub axle and also the wheel. So that is how the mechanism works. Now the second type is known as the screw and nut type, where we have a screw and nut arrangement movement of the components. The nut is made up of a phosphor bronze alloy, or it can be also a steel, and it is screwed into a ACME thread, multi-start ACME thread, which is formed on the inner column. So we have the different parts mentioned here. That is, we have the rocker shaft, and then the screw, this is the screw, and we have the nut arrangement, screw and nut arrangement. So this nut will rotate on the screw, and we have the ball race and the adjustment for the end float. The rotation of the nut is prevented by a ball fitted on the rocker, and this is not very commonly used arrangement. That is, screw and nut arrangement is not found very commonly in the steering mechanism or the steering gearboxes. The axial thrust of the column is taken by a single ball race fitted at the top end, and the nut sliding in the housing supports the lower end. So this is the mechanism, steer, screw and nut steering gearbox. This is not very commonly used. Then another commonly used type of arrangement is the recirculating ball mechanism, where it is a improvement over the worm and sector gear arrangement. So as I showed earlier in the animation, that animation was actually that of the recirculating ball mechanism. So there we have the rocker shaft, the guide track, that is, this is the guide track, the guide roller, then we have the rocker arm, and then we have the other components like shim and column adjustments, then nuts, transfer tube, rocker shaft, etc. So the advantage of using recirculating ball mechanism is that it has a higher efficiency as compared to standard worm and nut arrangement, and it uses a half nut mechanism with a transfer tube to move steel balls which rotate through the grooves in the worm. And the advantage is that it will give, or it has a very low coefficient of friction. So this is a arrangement of the mechanism. So you have the steering column, and the steering column will have a worm gear mechanism, and the worm gear is fed with steel balls in the grooves like this, and these are the ball return tubes. The balls will be fed and it will come and it will be returned through the tubes itself. And we have the steering nut and the steering screw and the shaft drop arm. So when the steering rotates, it will rotate, it will move, or it will rotate the worm wheel assembly, and the worm wheel is in contact, or the worm wheel is in contact with the sector gear assembly. The sector gear will rotate and it will again cause the movement of other components that are attached with the sector gear. So let us see the video. So in this video, this is the video of the recirculating ball mechanism. So this is the sector gear, and this is the ball return tube. So balls will be fed inside this casing. So inside the casing, the balls will be fed through these grooves, and it will help in reducing the coefficient of friction. Steel balls are used, and these steel balls, ball roller bearings are used and are recirculated within the grooves of this worm gear. So this is the figure. So these are the balls that are fed through the grooves of the worm gear. There is the worm shaft, and we have the balls and guides which are used to move or to put the balls outside, and this is the sector gear and this is the sector shaft. Then we have the cam and peg arrangement, where we have the tapered peg in the rocker arm which engages with a special cam on the inner column. And cam and peg arrangement, again, it is not very commonly used type of mechanism in the steering gearbox. The end float of the column is adjusted by components like shims, and the adjusting screw governs the backlash and end float on the rocker shaft. So this is not a very commonly used type of mechanism. Then another commonly used type is the worm and a roller mechanism, where a roller is engaging with the worm gear, so that when the worm gear rotates, this roller will rotate and it will cause the rotation of the steering wheel, of the wheels. So the steering wheel is connected with the steering shaft or steering column. Steering column is attached with the worm wheel. So when the steering is rotated, the worm wheel rotates, and when the worm wheel rotates, the roller will again rotate to and fro, and due to the movement of the roller rotation, it will cause the movement of the other components that are attached with the roller mechanism. So let us see the animation of the roller mechanism. So this is the roller mechanism. So as you can see that when the shaft is rotating, it will rotate the specially cut worm wheel. So this is not a normal cut, this is specially a typed groove, cut groove of the worm wheel, and this roller will rotate, and the roller is again attached to different components like the drop arm and other all things. So this will be linked with the tie rod linkage, and it will move the tie rod and the stub axle, and finally the wheels will be turned. So this is how the movement takes place within the steering box. Then the very commonly used type of system that is found commonly in almost all the cars is the rack and pinion arrangement. So in rack and pinion arrangement, we have the steering wheel, steering column, and the steering shaft. And this will come and mesh with the rack and pinion arrangement that is shown here at the bottom. So when the pinion rotates, the pinion is attached with the steering wheel. So when the steering wheel rotates, the pinion will rotate, and it will move the rack in the straight direction. So here the rotational motion of the steering wheel is converted to the straight motion or the linear motion of the rack and its assembly. And the tie rods at the end, the tie rods are attached through a ball joint, and we have a nylon covering. This is the nylon covering, and this tie rod again will be pushed or moved to the sides, to the left hand side or the right hand side, depending on the movement of the steering wheel. So we can see a video of the same. So for the rack and pinion arrangement, let us see how the working is. Most commonly used steering gear system, because it is very easy to manufacture and design. So this is a very basic animation being shown here. That is how the steering turns when the rack and pinion arrangement is working. So you can see another video of the rack and pinion arrangement. This is actually a model, a working model of the rack and pinion arrangement. So this is the steering wheel of the model. Actually, the steering wheel will be located really at the top, and then we have a steering column, and then there will be a universal joint, and then at the end of the universal joint there will be a pinion. So that universal joint and the steering column are absent in this model. So you can see the steering wheel, it is again directly connected with the pinion, because this is the model. So when the steering wheel is rotated, it will rotate the pinion wheel, and the pinion is engaged with the rack. You can see the rack teeth here. So rack is engaging with the pinion. So the movement of the pinion will cause the rack to move in either direction. So when the rack is moved, it will move the tie rods that are attached to either ends of the rack. And when tie rods are moving, it will, again, the tie rods are connected to the tie rod links or tie rod arms, and tie rod arms will be again connected to the stub axles. So stub axles will again be turned according to the movement of the tie rods, and thereby the wheel will be turned. So we can see the working, how it is works. See, when the wheel is turning, the pinion rotates and it will move the rack. So you can see as the rack rotates, the rack is being pushed to one side, the tie rods will also move accordingly. You can see the tie rods are moving in a straight line fashion. And these are the joints where the rack is connected with the tie rod. This is a ball joint. So this rubber bushing is given on either sides of the ball joints so that it prevents dust particles and also and water to get into the ball joint, ball and socket joint, and to prevent the damage of the ball and socket joint. So if dust particles accumulate or if water enters and corrosion happens, then there will be friction that is occurring and the ball joint will not function accurately. That is why there is a good covering, and this covering is usually made up of a plastic or a nylon material, rubber or nylon material. So you can see how the tie rods are moved, and the tie rods, since it is a ball joint, it can be moved in any direction. You can see here how the movement can be made. See, the tie rod can be rotated in any direction because it is a ball joint. So how the tie rods, we can rotate it freely because here it is a ball joint connecting the end of the rack with that of the tie rod. Now when the steering wheel rotates, it will rotate the pinion, and it will the pinion which is engaging with the rack, it will move the rack inwards and outwards, and thereby it will also move the tie rods accordingly. So that is how the steering of a rack and pinion arrangement takes place. Now there are certain features of rack and pinion arrangement. One problem that we notice with the standard rack and pinion arrangement is that greater the steering angle that is applied, the steering will be more heavier. So therefore some vehicles are fitted with a variable type of rack and pinion arrangement, which is a variable steering ratio. And secondly, to achieve a variable ratio, the pitch of the teeth on the pinion, they should be uniform, but on the rack they gradually decrease towards the end of the rack. That is, on either end of the rack, the distance between the teeth will be less. So we can say that there are more number of teeth for a given length at the end of the rack. So that is how we produce a variable steering ratio. So that will give a more lighter steering. Next, we move on to a power steering or power assisted steering. So power steering means when we are manually controlling the steering, the driver requires to apply a larger effort to turn the steering wheel, because even though there are steering gears and mechanisms, since the tire is in contact with the road, there is friction, and in order to turn this vehicle, it will require a large turning force. So manual steering will require larger force to turn the wheel through an angle. Therefore, some power assistance is given so that some of the power to turn the wheel will be given or provided by an external source, so that the driver has to exert only a very small amount of power or effort to turn the vehicle. So most of the power required to turn the wheel will be supplied by another source. That is known as power steering or power assisted steering. So the additional efforts make the driver's job very tiring and difficult. That is where we are using a manual steering. So in order to reduce the driver fatigue, we provide external power assistance known as power assisted steering. So to overcome the problems of heavy steering and to provide a reasonably responsive steering ratio, many of the vehicles are now given a power steering. So most of the vehicles nowadays have power steering. So why do we need to use power steering?
because at low speeds, when the tire has greater contact with the road, the friction will be more and more effort will be needed to turn the vehicle. But when power steering is used, only less effort will be needed. Then again, at low tire pressures also, the turning will be difficult because the contact area is more. So again, at low tire pressures, if you want to turn the wheels easily, power steering will be necessary. Large tire contact area, for larger tires again, larger contact area is there and larger friction is there. So in that case also we need power steering. And for tight cornering also we need power steering. Some requirements that are needed for power assistance. It must be fail safe. That means if the power, even if the power assistance system fails, the driver must be able to control the steering. So in some cases, sometimes the power assistance may fail. So the vehicle should not lose control. The driver should be able to effectively control the remaining manual system. Then the degree of assistance provided by the power assistance system should be proportionate to the effort applied by the driver. So when the driver is turning the wheel, the steering wheel, the actual wheel of the vehicle that is turned will or should be proportional with the turning angle of the steering wheel. That means the driver should be able to feel the movement of the wheels. Then on light vehicles, the hydraulic power or electric power is used to assist the driver to steer the vehicles. So either hydraulic powered the hydraulic power steering or electric power steering is available in vehicles. So mainly there are two types of power steerings. One is integral type, another is the linkage type. So integral type of steering has the power piston integrated with the steering gear setup. Whereas in linkage type, the power piston is connected between the frame and the steering linkage. So you can see the hydraulically assisted power assisted system here. We have the steering column and we have a rotary valve and the excess, we use mineral oil as a hydraulic fluid, and we have the rack and piston arrangement. So these are the fluid lines or the tubes which transfer or transmit the mineral oil, and the excess oil is pumped to the reservoir, and we have a oil pump which pumps oil into the system and it moves into the channel. So when the oil is pumped at high pressure, it moves through the system and through the tubes into a larger area where the pressure of the oil will push a piston, and this piston movement will cause the movement of the rack that is attached with the piston assembly. So we have a piston and a shaft assembly, and at the end of the shaft we have the rack. So when the oil comes and exerts pressure on one side of the piston is moving towards the other side, and due to that movement the rack will also move. So this rack arrangement, the rack gears which are mounted, will move easily and it will cause the movement, and it will help in the movement of the entire assembly. So we have the steering located here. So when the driver rotates the steering column will rotate, and the pinion gear will also rotate. So but when the pinion gear rotates, at the same time the piston movement is also taking place, and therefore the driver has to exert only very less amount of force to turn the steering. The other force is exerted on the piston by this oil, so that the movement of the rack becomes easier. So as a result, only lesser effort has to be spent by the driver. So hydraulically operated power systems are based either on constant pressure or constant flow layout. In constant pressure layout, a constant pressure is maintained by a hydraulic accumulator. Whereas in constant flow layout, we have a fluid flowing around the system continuously until the assistance is required. So in constant flow, the oil flow remains constantly or remains continuously throughout the system. Whereas at constant pressure type, there is a hydraulic accumulator which maintains a particular pressure of the oil. So most hydraulic steering systems use constant flow system where the fluid flows through the system continuously. Then the other systems or components that are required in hydraulic system are a hydraulic pump to pump the oil. Then we need to have a control valve and also a ram cylinder or the piston. The hydraulic pump supplies oil to a control valve situated in the housing, and when steering is in the straight ahead position, the control valve is in the neutral position and the fluid passed through the control valve and returns to the pump or the reservoir. So when under normal condition, this is the control valve, it remains open so that when the pump pumps the oil flows through the system and it will go back to the reservoir. And the piston is in the central position. Whenever the steering is turned, the movement causes the turning of control valve so that the oil flow will take place only in one direction and it will push the piston to another direction. So there is a turning of the wheels according to the turning of the control valve. So when we turn the steering wheel, accordingly the control valve will also turn and thereby oil will fall into the area and exerts force on the piston. When the steering wheel is turned to the other side, the control valve will turn to the other side so that the oil will enter to the other area of the cylinder and push the piston to the other area, to the opposite side. And therefore, the turning will also be taking place to the other side. And this pump, hydraulic pump, is usually operated by the engine crankshaft connection. It is connected by a V-belt from the engine crankshaft. And the type of pump, hydraulic oil pump, is usually an eccentric type, a rotor or a vane pump. And the hydraulic fluid used is usually a low viscosity mineral oil. Low viscosity oil because whenever we turn the vehicle, the movement has to be transferred quickly to the wheels. So if it is a high viscosity oil, the oil flow will be very slow and therefore the force transmitted will take so much of time. So but since it is a steering system, the force has to be transmitted almost instantaneously and therefore we use a very low viscosity mineral oil. Then we have the electric motor power assisted steering where the hydraulic system is replaced entirely by an electric system. So it is, if the hydraulic system is fitted to a vehicle with a small capacity engine, then the hydraulic system takes more power from the engine, especially when the engine rotates at a very low speed, is operating at a low speed. So hydraulic power system is usually found in vehicles which have a larger capacity engines. When the engine is operating at low speeds, the energy consumed by the engine to drive the pump, the hydraulic pump, is more because the engine crankshaft is directly connected to the hydraulic oil pump. So if the speed is low, engine crankshaft speed is low, then correspondingly the hydraulic power steering pump will also be acting in a low speed so that the force produced will also be low. So effective steering will not be taking place. And also emissions from the engine will increase as the engine system stabilizes engine speed by adjusting the fuel and ignition settings to suit. So therefore the hydraulic system is not suitable for low capacity engines. So small engines, modern vehicles with small engines are fitted with electric motors. So the entire hydraulic system or the hydraulic power system is replaced by an electric power system. We have an electric DC motor. It is fitted to the steering column. Through the use of a worm gear and gear wheel rotates the steering column in the both the directions when an electric current is applied to the motor. So using an alternator arrangement from the battery, the DC motor will give an energy, or it will give or help in rotating the steering column by a gear wheel arrangement. So the rotation of the motor generates power assistance. So thereby, when we are manually turning the steering wheel, the power to the electric motor will be turned on, and the electric motor will help in turning the gear mechanism, the steering in the gear steering gearbox, and it will help in assisting or giving power to the manual mechanism. And the electronic control unit regulates when the current is applied to the motor. So whenever the steering gear, the steering wheel is rotated, the ECU turns on the DC electric motor, and the electric motor will turn or generate the assistance, power assistance to the steering column. So that is the mechanism of the electric steering mechanism.